And here we will discuss about meristem culture and somaclonal variation. Meristem culture, I will take the practical approach, and somaclonal variation, as it's a kind of new topic for you because some variation will come suddenly. So I will go more theoretical aspects of this somaclonal variation. By the time you people have enough idea about various aspects of plant tissue culture, some events, not necessarily molecular events, but yes, the physical events which is taking place, how you subculture, what are the consequences, what are the factors, role of antibiotics, role of hormone, micropropagation, callus culture, these all you know. Today, after this lecture, there will be a practical session. In that, I will show you the real callus of Nicotiana tabacum, how it looks like, and how you grow plant, and how beautiful a plant looks like if you grow through tissue culture. Also, there will be a small discussion on hydroponics. What I feel that hydroponics is an extension of plant tissue culture. And nowadays, because of the expanding population, this hydroponics has slowly and steadily finding its place in our home also. So I will give you the basic idea of hydroponics as well. So to start with this meristem culture, now go back to the history. Some 70 years back, Morrell and Martin developed the technique of meristem culture for in vivo virus eradication of Dahlia. In this technique, shoots of all angiosperm and gymnosperm are grown by virtue of their apical meristem. Fine. So there is a great role of apical meristem here, because this meristem is ultimately derived from this apical meristem, and this meristem, or in other names like shoot tips, is isolated from a stem by applying a small cut with the help of a small knife or scalpel. And in several cases, it is being observed as MS media, the salts coupled is salt inculcated in MS media, the hormone. They all play a very good role for the development of this meristem culture. This is apical meristem. There are four divisions here. The first one is zone of cell division. This zone is very much active, and the meristem obviously is present here. This is zone of cell elongation. And this is zone of differentiation. In the last, this is a permanent tissue which is already in differentiated stage. So for redifferentiation or de-differentiation, I mean, they have to follow some other mechanism, and this is beyond the scope of our discussion. So this is a flow diagram which illustrates the technique of this meristem culture. If you look, I mean, as a participant, you can easily analyze that the way the tissue culture is being done, either it's micropropagation, either it's general tissue culture, or it's a development of transgenic. Some steps are very much common, but what is different? The different is your start material. Fine. The start material, the media, these two things are maybe not common, maybe different from different procedures. So, because I have seen in my previous slide that you have to take care of this portion, and this portion is delicate. Here, you need expertise to isolate this particular segment. Now, take out this segment. Fine, and this is actually very small, but I'm This is the magnified view of shoot tip, and meristem is excised from there, and it is put on the specific culture media. After a period, if I say around 2 weeks or so, new shoots start coming out from the culture, and it is transplanted into another chamber. Because it's a large scale production, so obviously the chamber which is being used to develop this large scale is also very big. And the hardened plant, hardening is a kind of acclimatization, and acclimatization is necessary because, as I said in my earlier lectures, that these new grown plants are like babies coming from ICU, so they need proper caring. So after this hardening, which is usually 5 to 7 days, they are again potted in natural conditions, and there from there it can be used, whatever the use may be, whatever the objectives it has been taken at the start of this experiment. So the stages of tissue culture, I have kept all the discussion in a more practical way. So actually this was developed by Murasige at most. They have reported that there are 3 stages of culture. In the stage 1, that is the culture establishment stage, when explant may develop into single shoot or multiple shoots. One may ask question that, sir, why single shoot or multiple shoots? I mean, is there any control? Then my answer will be no. No, my child, there is no control. Because the program which is set inside a particular cell, we can't check it phenotypically. So we don't know that there is a possibility of multiple shooting from a particular shoot. So this can be, it cannot be ascertained, it cannot be determined at the start of the culture. So in this stage, these explants are actually supplemented with cytokinin, benzyl aminopurine, BAP, we call it BAP. And in stage 2, the objective is multiplication. If you see the same picture, this is a diagrammatic representation of the stages. This slide and this slide both have the same picture. So now come, this is first, like primary culture, and this is second one, that is shoot development without axillary shoots. Here the rooting starts. So in the second stage, the objective is to multiply this propagule, and for this axillary shoot proliferation is followed. Why it is followed? Because, you know, the genetic stability is a must thing. If any plant is genetically unstable, you cannot control its technique, way of proliferation, and maybe there is a change in leaf structure, and those phenomena are actually comes under the soma clonal variation. So a tissue culturist want their plant to be genetically stable. Fine. So this is the reason high amount of cytokine is utilized, fine, to overcome the apical dominance. In the stage 3, the purpose is the regeneration of adventitious roots from the shoot which is obtained here. So numerous studies have indicated that NA followed by IBA, IEA 240, and other auxins are used for induction of root generation. As in your hormonal chapter, you have now well understood that every hormone play a definite role for the production of shoot, root, callus, or the combination. In organic nutrient, carbon source in the form of sugar. Sugar is available in several forms. It may be glucose, it may be fructose. I mean, they are monomers. But generally, if you run your, want to run your media, want to run your experiment for a longer period, you can use sucrose. Fine. This sucrose is not a monomer. So when it has to give energy to this whole set, it has to transform into monomer. Then only it can start giving energy to the whole set, to your whole culture. So it runs longer time, for longer period. So it is one of the best method to run longer, just use sucrose in your experiment, because glucose and fructose, which are monomers, it can be directly utilized in your experiment, and your experiment become halts in maybe in 2 days or 3 days. Vitamins, they have a role, because without vitamins, you cannot sustain. There will be a problem. There can be yellowing of leaf. There can be multiple shooting, which cannot be controlled. You never know how it affects the whole cellular system. And plant growth hormones like auxin, then higher cytokinin, pH. pH must be between 5.6 to 5.8, and not, we generally try not to make it more than 6 pH, because if the pH is high, it actually inhibits the growth, or it is, if it is lower in more acidic zone, it also halts the growth. So this is step-by-step method how you attain your meristem culture practices. To remove the young twigs from a healthy plant, cut the tip portion of the twig. Then surface sterilization. You have to use sodium hypochlorite solution. Don't use a very harsh, a very sharp, very tough sterilizer. Otherwise, it will destroy the meristem and you're not going to achieve anything. Then transfer each explant, that is start material. Here, explant is, it's like the start material. So this explant is here, in this case is your meristem. So transfer each explant to a sterilized petri dish. Here you can see how it is transferring to a petri dish in a inside a laminar flow. And remove the outer leaves from its shoot. And after the removal of outer leaves, the apex is exposed now. Cut off the ultimate apex with the help of a scalpel and transfer only those which are very smaller in length. That is, the size is mentioned here, that it is 1 millimeter. And incubate the culture in 8 by 16 D by N. Means 8 hours of dark period and 16 hours of light period. As soon as growing single leafy shoot or multiple shoots obtained from single shoot tip or meristem, it is advised to transfer them to hormone-free medium to develop roots. Fine, like at some stage of your tissue culture, in a general tissue culture or any practices, if you obtain shoot and it shows that, yes, it is like, it is now stable. So generally, we do not use any kind of hormone or any kind of antibiotic. It is given hormone-free and antibiotic-free media so that they do not hinder to the growth of a particular plant. And at the end, the plant is transferred to pots which contain compost and kept under greenhouse condition for hardening. Now I directly jump to the application of meristem culture. The first one is virus elimination. Somebody asked me some 2-3 days back that why it is like used for virus elimination. So I have given 2-3 reasons. One was production of auxin from that root, from this tip. It actually helps in down-regulating the accumulation of virus over there. So plants, as you know, they are static. They are a static entity. So they are always in the risk of infection. Fine. And some are known and some are unknown. So this plant, which is grown through this meristem culture, and this is popularly sold by any commercial horticulturist as a virus-free plant, that please take it, this is a virus-free plant, that's not going to harm anything. Because, you know, virus, if you take any virus-infected plant in your nursery, there is a very high chance that other plants also get infected. And it is difficult to control there once it is spread over there. That's why this plant is being preferred over other. Micropropagation. You have now pretty good idea about micropropagation. These are, this meristem culture is a boon for micropropagation. Like once it is, you get some plant through meristem culture, they are go for asexual propagation of the whole plant using this micropropagation technique. The storage of genetic resource, you know, some seeds are recalcitrant. Recalcitrant mean they do not resist to high heat or low temperature. So this plant, these seeds are not viable after some time. So you cannot store those seeds for to maintain your genetic resource. You know, every country maintain their genetic resource, because in every 2-3 years there are large number of plants which get extinct. And if this practice will continue, after some time all the vulnerable plant, all the good plants may be extinct, then what we will do? So every country, they store their genetic resource. The meristem from such plant are stored in vitro and used in plant breeding. In many plant breeding experiments, the hybrid plant produce a seed which are non-viable. We can say they are kind of eunuchs. So as a result, it makes a barrier in the crosses between two plants. Fine. So these non-viable seeds are unable to develop into mature plants. So shoot tip or meristem from such hybrid plant can be cultured to speed up your breeding program. And this quarantine, nowadays you people are very much familiar with this word quarantine. You know, the world is like one small village. Fine. A research or a plant breeding or make development of genetic repository is a regular practice across the globe. Fine. So if you are taking something from China or from France or from US at airport, you have to undergo a very strict mechanism. You cannot take anything which can create a problem, because nobody knows what you are taking in this petri plate. So this shoot tip of meristem culture is accepted by any quarantine authority or any kind of international exchange without any kind of checking. So from next time, if you go for such kind of practices, you remember that you must bring your meristem cultured thing in a petri plate. Fine. So exploitation of meristem culture. So meristem culture has been used in eradication of banana virus. The quotation of there is two BMV and BVTV. BMV is a broom mosaic virus and BVTV is banana bunchy top virus. It is a very common disease which is found all over in Uttar Pradesh. And so this meristem culture is used for the production of certified banana plant, which is free from this BVTV at least. And elimination of virus, PPV. PPV is porcine parvovirus. And PNRSV is Prunus necrotic ring spot virus. So many plants are, these are not much reported from our country, but in African countries, they are very much prevalent. So with the help of this thermotherapy and meristem tip culture, this virus is being eliminated. And this chrysanthemum and development of several pathogen-free plants, even these are very much effective in against fungus, bacteria, mycoplasma, etc. So this is a list of plants. So this is a list of plant from which viruses has been eliminated by meristem culture. A number of plant species, and some of them are really commercially important. These all are being developed through the meristem culture or protected through meristem culture, whatever the case may be. And the list of the viruses, some of them I have already quoted, which are very much reported across the globe, and there are some other viruses like cucumber mosaic virus is a kind of ubiquitous virus, and as per my view, it is difficult to eradicate, only you can manage it. So these are the advantages. And the advantages are mostly cryopreservation and in vitro conservation of germplasm. This is the most important advantage. And disadvantages, as you know, in the start of tissue culture, my first lecture, I have told that high level of expertise is required. This is considered as disadvantage. Fine. So its isolation is actually difficult because you need a special kind of training to isolate such kind of very sophisticated parts from a plant. Fine. And sometimes the regeneration time is very high, and sometimes it increases for 7 to 8 months. And you know, to subculture for 7 to 8 months, it increases the overall cost. So these are some of the disadvantages. Otherwise, this is really a good practice, really good technique to follow. So my next, this is all about your meristem culture, meristem technique. Now we come to this somaclonal variation. Somaclonal variation. I start with a small introduction to this somaclonal variation. It is a variation which is seen in plants that has been produced by plant tissue culture. Chromosomal rearrangement are an important source of this variation. The term somaclonal variation is a phenomena and a broad taxonomic occurrence. And it is, you know, reported from the species of different priority levels. And for outcrossing and inbreeding vegetatively and seed propagation and cultivation and non-cultivated plant. And the characters which is being affected by this somaclonal variations, it includes both qualitative and quantitative trait. So what are the basic features of somaclonal variation? Variation in number and structure of chromosomes are commonly observed, and regenerated plants with altered chromosomal changes often show changes in leaf shape, color, growth rate, and habit and sexual fertility. Fine, it is generally a heritable mutation and persist in plant population even after plantation into the field. Then there are certain questions, ki bhai aisa kyun hota hai? You know, some of you have asked me a question, ki sir isme to कोई वेरिएशन होता है कि नहीं जब हम टिश्यू कल्चर करते हैं। ट्रेट्स की बात आई थी तो मैंने कहा था नहीं कोई नया ट्रेट नहीं। द थिंग इज दैट ट्रेट बिकॉज ऑफ सोमाक्लोनल वेरिएशन देयर कैन बी चांसेस ऑफ अकरेंस ऑफ सम न्यू ट्रेट्स, बट माई क्वेश्चन इज दैट ट्रेट इज इन अंडर द कंट्रोल ऑफ द टिश्यू कल्चरिस्ट? नो इट इज नॉट। यू कैन नॉट कंट्रोल द ट्रेट्स विच इज यू नो सडनली अपीयर्स ड्यूरिंग योर सब कल्चरिंग। द ट्रेट्स आर दोज विच कैन बी कंट्रोल्ड एंड विच कैन बी यूज फर्दर, बट समटाइम्स द ट्रेट्स विच इज अकर्ड सडनली बिकॉज ऑफ दिस सोमाक्लोनल वेरिएशन इट इज रियली डिफिकल्ट टू कंट्रोल एंड समटाइम्स इट इज ऑफ नो यूज। फाइन। सो मैकेनिज्म ऑफ सोमाक्लोनल वेरिएशंस इट इज लाइक जेनेटिक एंड एपिजेनेटिक। आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू डिस्कस सम एपिजेनेटिक मैकेनिज्म ऑल्सो हियर। सो जेनेटिक इज हेरिटेबल। हाउ इट अपीयर्स? यू नो द टिश्यू कल्चर स्टार्ट्स विथ एक्सप्लांट्स। गुड। यू डोंट नो द एक्सप्लांट विच यू हैव टेकन फ्रॉम योर नर्सरी और you have taken from commercially available sources. You never know because once the plant which is kept outside, it is in consistent attack with microbe and other kind of stresses. The stress are of two kind, biotic and abiotic stress. The biotic stress is like all the microbes, including I am also including humans are also biotic stress. Fine. The abiotic stress is the mostly are changing environment. This is one of the most, you know, shouted, a most designated abiotic stress. So because of this stress, there is a chance that there is sudden change in mutation. There is sudden change in the genetic makeup that is called mutation. Or there is some alteration of some chromosomal behavior. And just merely looking into that plant, it is not possible to identify that, yes, this plant is already altered. It is very difficult. Fine. And it is also difficult to evaluate each and every explant before going for our tissue culture. So generally we take the explant, wherever from we get an explant, a start material for our tissue culture experiment. So this genetic heritable variation, these are actually pre-existing variation in the somatic cell of the explant. And they are caused by mutations and other DNA changes and occur in high frequency. Once a mutation has taken place and you are going for culturing those, you cannot control, because in every subculturing, that mutation, that error rate is start increasing, and at some point of time you never know and it is not in your control. So in the further discussion I will give you some idea how to just make a small check in this kind of variation on the basis of my experience in tissue culture. And second one is epigenetic mechanism. Through epigenetic mechanism, they are actually non-heritable variation. You know, when a plant, or even we the humans, we are facing a tough situation, a tough change in culture, tough change in environment, tough change in, you know, working in some plastic factory or maybe working in a Middle East country. So all the time, is all the time ready to sustain such kind of changing scenario? No, it is not. So sometimes the nucleus, with the help of this, because of this changing nature of the your surrounding, they start producing some kind of non-coding RNAs, which are actually regulatory molecules. So for some point of time, they just try to maintain the homeostasis of that particular organism. maybe plant or maybe microbe or maybe humans, it doesn't matter. So, but they are not heritable. I mean, this character of your survivability potential is not going to pass on you to your progeny. This is a kind of your local repairment system, which is being ubiquitously present in all kind of organisms, whether it's animal, whether it's fungus, whether it's plant. So this ubiquitous mechanism is actually regulated by your non-coding RNA. Fine. So the steps involve induction and selection of soma clonal variation. This callus tissue, organogenesis, regenerated plant, hardening, soma clonal variation. These are the very basic steps which shows that soma clonal variation is inevitable. So the causes of soma clonal variation, there are three causes, like physiological causes. I have elaborated this already. Genetic cause, you know, I have given one specific example, and there are some biochemical causes. So how these biochemical causes? Today itself, I have told that when you obtain shoot, don't always use a set of antibiotics or a set of hormone, because they somehow interfere with the genetic makeup of the plant. Fine. So this biochemical, which any tissue culturist is using to grow plants, they somehow enter into the chain of the plant, and there can be a possible changing in genetic makeup. There can be a possibility that it can interact with the chromosomal, with the chromosomes. Fine. The chromosomes or DNA, they are all made up of four letters coupled with phosphate, coupled with some backbones. So there is a possibility of interaction, and how this interaction takes place. You know, there, if you are using biochemicals there, or synthetic chemicals, because the media is also synthetic, there is a chance that some lone pair of electrons will start removing to the whole system. And if this lone pair of electron start moving into the whole system, it can change the electronic level. The electronic level, the distribution of electrons in the whole system. Once it gets disturbed, this will affect the nuclear functionality. Once the nuclear function gets affected, there can be there is 100% chance of variation. Fine. This is one kind of explanation. There are several other explanations. You can go and you can read the textbooks. So these are the physiological causes. Exposure of culture to plant growth regulators, already discussed. Culture conditions. You know, culture condition is one of the very important aspect. If you take an older culture, the actively dividing cells are always less. So there will be two things, like it will take time to come to their actively dividing stage. And second, the percentage of error in that culture is high. So you have to face problem, and that is for sure. So it is advised that don't take culture which are too old. So these are the theoretical things: genetic causes, gene change in chromosome number, change in chromosome structure. Like if you analyze, if you have detected that, yes, there is a change, if you analyze, so these can be a possible genetic causes, genetic things which you can detect. either it's a change in chromosome number or change in chromosome structure. The reason may be one or maybe many. Mutation, transposable animal element activation, and change in DNA, change in protein, methylation of DNA. So methylation, hypermethylation of DNA, they all are epigenetic changes. Once it is get methylated or hypermethylated, the whole promoter system get disturbed. If a promoter system get disturbed, then the whole transcription and translation get disturbed. We are not going to get protein or a correctly folded protein. So if it is so, you will get altered phenotypes in the name of somaclonal variation. So biochemical causes, lack of photosynthetic ability due to alteration in carbon metabolism, biosynthesis of starch via carotenoid pathway, nitrogen metabolism, antibiotic resistance. So these are some of the things which I want to discuss. Advantages. There are so many advantages. The major likely benefit of somaclonal variation is crop improvement. Fine. So somaclonal variation leads to the creation of additional genetic variability. You have to segregate that which variability, which variation actually is beneficial and which is not. And characteristics for which somaclonal mutation can be enriched during your in vitro culture. Once you detected that a particular set, a particular event in plant tissue culture has some variation and this variation is good, you just go on with this variable set of tissue culture plant and you will get a number of genetic variable plant which you can use according to your need. And resistance to disease, so many pathotoxins, herbicide, high salt concentration, mineral toxicity, tolerance to environmental or chemical stress, as well as for increased production of secondary metabolites. The use of secondary metabolites are many. So with the help of this somaclonal variation, you can go for high production of secondary metabolites. So what are the applications? It is improvement of existing clonal cultures, sugarcane. Somaclonal variation ka sugarcane improvement mein bahut zyada use hua hai worldwide. Potato mein hua hai. Fine. To agar aap dekho to jo root hai, jo tubers hai aur jo juicy material hai, isme zyada kaam hua hai somaclonal variation mein, jo meri observation hai. ठीक है. डिसएडवांटेजेस भी हैं. डिसएडवांटेज में होता क्या है कि इट समटाइम्स लीड टू अनडिजायरेबल रिजल्ट्स एंड सिलेक्टेड वेरिएंट्स आर रैंडम एंड जेनेटिकली अनस्टेबल. जेनेटिक अनस्टेबिलिटी इज लाइक वन ऑफ द मेजर डिसएडवांटेजेस फॉर इफ यू टॉक अबाउट योर सोमाक्लोनल वेरिएशन एंड नॉट सुटेबल फॉर कॉम्प्लेक्स एग्रोनॉमिक ट्रेड्स फॉर यील्ड एंड क्वालिटी बिकॉज इन द स्टार्ट आई हैव सेड दैट it is difficult to control. Aap control nahi kar sakte ho. Once it is not controllable, so you cannot go for very complex machinery, very complex agronomic traits. And many developed varieties, it shows pleiotropic effect. One gene has many function. So if one gene starts showing many functions, it is difficult to control again. So ye aapka ho gaya. बट इसे रिड्यूस कैसे करोगे? हाउ यू रिड्यूस सोमाक्लोनल वेरिएशन? बिकॉज इन एवरी एक्सपेरिमेंट यू डोंट वॉन्ट दैट वेरिएशन मे कम. सो वॉट यू विल डू? सो डिफरेंट स्टेप्स विच कैन बी यूज टू रिड्यूस सोमाक्लोनल वेरिएशन. इट इज वेल नोन दैट इंक्रीजिंग नंबर ऑफ सब कल्चर इंक्रीज द लाइक्लीहुड ऑफ सोमाक्लोनल वेरिएशन. So the number of subculture should be kept to minimum. If the number of subculture is kept to minimum, there is a less chance, I mean, you just cut the percentage of somaclonal variation. And you initiate the clones every time with new explant. It might reduce the variability over a certain time period. Another way of reducing somaclonal variation that avoid using 2,4-D, 2,4-dichlorophenoxyacetic acid in the culture media, because this hormone is actually introduce variation. Fine, so just try to just avoid the use of 2,4-D or minimize the use of 2,4-D. And if you really want to create some variation, increase the use of 2,4-D. Fine. So this is all about your somaclonal variation. And I request that whatever the knowledge you have gained through this tissue culture experiments, you can definitely start a tissue culture experiment, and you can use the idea which you have gained in your 3-4 days classes. Ma'am, isko band kar dijiye.